Daily Minutes nummer 1539 met een uitzending van vandaag, 2 februari 2019. Dit is het bulletin van zaterdag. The major part of this bulletin will be in English. Deze uitzending is grotendeels in het Engels, maar ik begin met wat Nederlands. Vandaag heb ik als data 4 SSTV-plaatjes. Oh jee, XTV. Ik hoop niet dat het te horen is, maar het zal haast wel. Omdat ik steeds in tijdproblemen raak bij het maken van slow scan radio, ga ik de komende week doen wat ik eerder al aangekondigd heb. Ik ga de Daily Minutes als data vrijwel iedere dag 2 of meer SSTV-plaatjes uitzenden, die de zaterdag erop dan bij slow scan radio te zien zullen zijn, te zien en te horen. Op die manier kan ik het werk voor dit radioprogramma in gedeelten doen. Ik blijf daarnaast ook met data experimenteren, die deels ook weer moet leiden tot data experimenten op zaterdagmiddag op 60, 70 kHz. Het is niet helemaal duidelijk waarom het maken van die uitzending zo lang duurt op zaterdag, maar het blijkt inderdaad vaak 3,5 tot 4 uur of soms zelfs een stuk langer in te zitten. En als je het bekijkt, dan is het, die plaatjes moeten geknipt worden, die moeten op kleur bewerkt worden, ze moeten gedigitaliseerd worden, aan elkaar geplakt. En voordat je de foto's gevonden hebt, ben je ook nog wel even bezig. Dus Daar schort het ook wel vaak aan dat de inspiratie een beetje hapert op het moment dat de tijddruk al te groot wordt. Hè. Meestal dan stijgt mijn inspiratie met de deadline die naderbij komt. Maar op een bepaald moment neemt dat weer catastrofaal af. En dat is een paar keer gebeurd bij Slow Scan Radio. Maar goed, er is wel elke keer een uitzending geweest. We gaan verder met het Engelse deel van de uitzending.
This is ARRL Audio News, your weekly summary of news highlights from the world of amateur radio. If you retransmit audio news through a repeater, listen for the Morse code K character, followed by 4 seconds of silence. That's your cue to stop transmitting so that your repeater timer can reset.
I'm Carla Pereira, KC1HSX, and these are our stories for Friday, February 1st. A demanding agenda faced the ARRL Board of Directors when it convened for its annual meeting January 18th and 19th. Several new faces were around the table, with 4 newly elected ARRL directors, 1 newly elected vice director, and 1 recently appointed vice director. Attending for their first meeting as board members were Hudson Division Director Rhea Jiram, N2RJ, New England Division Director Fred Hopengarten, K1VR, Northwestern Division Director Mike Ritz, W7VO, and Roanoke Division Director George Bud Hippisley, W2RU. Also present were Northwestern Division Vice Director Mark Tharp, KB7HDX, and Rocky Mountain Division Vice Director Robert Wareham, N0ESQ, who was appointed last fall to fill a vacancy. On a voice vote, the board authorized $485,000 to fund a project carried out by Connecticut Media and Advertising Consultants Minson Hoke to develop lifelong learning strategies and programs aimed at attracting and retaining ARRL members, especially newly licensed radio amateurs. The board adopted an ARES plan as recommended by the Programs and Services Committee. Committee Chair Dale Williams said the ARES plan will establish training programs and 3 levels of ARES membership. The board received the report of ARRL CEO Howard Mickle, WB2ITX, who outlined plans to reorganize and refocus the activities at ARRL headquarters. Mickle said providing better value to membership is a top priority, and he sees value creation and value delivery as key components to long-term membership retention and growth. The board repealed the ARRL policy on board governance and conduct of members of the board of directors and vice directors, commonly known as the Code of Conduct, on an 11-3 vote with 1 abstention. As already announced, the board withdrew, without prejudice to refiling, ARRL's December 18, 2018 petition for rulemaking to the FCC, which sought to amend the Part 97 Amateur Service Rules to incorporate the provisions of the Amateur Radio Parity Act, or ARPA. The board said that ARRL needs to review, re-examine, and reappraise ARRL's regulatory and legislative policy with regard to private land use restrictions. For those just getting started on their amateur radio journey, the podcast So Now What? Will launch on Thursday, March 7th, and new episodes will be posted every other Thursday, alternating new episode weeks with the ARRL The Doctor Is In podcast. Co-hosting So Now What? Will be ARRL Communications Content Producer Michelle Patnode, W3MVP, and ARRL Station Manager Joe Karsha, NJ1Q. Presented as a lively conversation, with Patnode representing newer hams and Karsha the veteran operators, the podcast will explore questions that newer hams may have and the issues that keep participants from staying active in the hobby. Some episodes will feature guests to answer questions on specific topic areas. Topics to be discussed in the first several episodes include getting started, operating modes available to technician licensees, VEC and licensing issues, sunspots and propagation, mobile operating, contesting, amateur radio and pop culture, and perceptions of technician license holders. Given the growing popularity of podcasts, ISGR believes that providing this information in a podcast format will be a very effective method of reaching out and engaging this particular part of the amateur radio community, which is important for building and maintaining amateur radio interest and activity. Listeners will be able to find the So Now What podcast on Apple iTunes, Blueberry, or Stitcher, free registration required, or browse the site as a guest, and through the free Stitcher app for iOS, Kindle, or Android devices, or wherever you get your podcasts. Episodes will also be archived on the ARRL website. Some of the enthusiasm engendered by youngsters on the air, known simply as Yoda, has spilled over into IARU Region 2. A group of a half dozen young radio operators, calling itself Team Exuberance, will visit the contest superstation of Tim Duffy, K3LR, in late March for the CQ Worldwide WPX SSB event. The team was inspired in part by Yoda's youth contesting program in Europe, which arranges for youthful IARU Region 1 members to participate in contests from Top Gun stations. Last year's YCP station hosts included ES5TV, 9A1A, EC2DX, 403A, and DM9EE, with more YCP events planned for 2019.
And now with this week's satellite update, here's Bruce Page, KK5DO.
Origami Sat 1 is now known as Fuji Oscar 98 or FO98. And Nexus, which launched at the same time, has been granted Fuji Oscar 99 or FO99. I spoke of maybe upgrading your station to receive the 5.8 GHz downlink from Origami Sat 1 or FO98. This is a bit more of a challenge than you might think. First of all, you have to have a 2-foot or 3-foot dish. You're going to have to keep it pointed at the satellite while correcting for Doppler. Doppler in this case at such a high frequency can be a bit over 100 kHz. Then, with a short footprint of say 10 to 15 minutes, you really have to be spot on with all your equipment in order to receive the downlink. Think you're up to the challenge? It is worth giving it a shot if you're into microwaves. To make it even more of a challenge, it transmits for 5 seconds and is off for 10 seconds. We mentioned how 8085 has battery issues. The satellite has been placed in transponder mode and may switch in and out of safe mode. Please keep your power down if you're going to use a satellite in order to preserve the batteries as much as possible. This is Bruce Page, KK5DO, for the ARRL Audio News.
This is the ARRL Audio News Propagation Forecast for Friday, February 1st. We have a small sunspot that'll be sliding out of view within the next few days, and it's been tossing out a few solar flares. As a result, the solar flux index has edged up to about 74, and there have been some reports of significant band openings on 15 meters. Better enjoy it while you can. We're also entering a stream of solar particles thanks to a big hole in the sun's atmosphere, so expect some geomagnetic disruptions over the next several days or so. On VHF and UHF, all that dry Arctic air has really shut down the tropospheric band openings throughout the country, with one exception, the coasts of Oregon and Washington.
And that concludes ARRL Audio News for this week. Our thanks to all contributors to this week's report. ARRL Audio News is produced by the American Radio Relay League, the National Association for Amateur Radio. For more information on amateur radio or the ARRL, visit us on the web at arrl.org. You can also find us on Facebook and Twitter by searching for ARRL. If you have a question or comment about ARRL Audio News, email us at audionews@arrl.org. This program is copyright ARRL, all rights reserved. 73, and thanks for listening.
Foundations of Amateur Radio. Operating your amateur radio station at home, in your shack, is one of the often discussed aspects of our hobby. Much has been said about installation, antennas, grounding, and the like. But what if you want to operate mobile? Picking a location, of all the locations available to you, can be quite the task. For some, it's daunting. Others find it challenging. Others take to it with ease, and often you find yourself overwhelmed by choice. What makes a good operating location? What should you look for? And how do you do this better? First thing to consider is that options give you choice. Choice gives you uncertainty, which can lead to stress and other unpleasantness. If you're completely flummoxed as to how to select a location, visit the Summits on the Air website or the Worldwide Flora and Fauna site and see which of the qualifying locations is reachable for you. The choice becomes much easier if you don't have a choice. Picking from a prescribed list makes it easier to start, and the more you do it, the more you'll learn about what makes a good operating location and what doesn't. Restricting your options is one path to success, but there are others. Over the years, I've pored over maps, looked at places that qualified, tried, and failed many times. Things I look for when I'm hunting for a new place to operate from include the ability for my car to get there. I live in Australia, often shade is a consideration, away from buildings and other sources of interference. I tend to go for places that have water nearby, preferably the ocean, but I also frequent lakes and rivers. If I'm operating on VHF and UHF for a local contest, I might look for a high point, something that has clear line of sight to the local amateur community. In my case, a high hill or the local ranges overlooking the city basin. For one contest, I needed to visit local shires, and to do that, I created a map showing all the shire boundaries. I then used that map to scout possible locations and took into account how to get from this shire to the next. I learned from that exercise that the ground beneath the operating location matters. Sand versus gravel, gravel versus granite, granite versus swamp. I also learned that overhead power lines are hard to spot on a map, but avoiding them is essential to success. Depending on how long you plan to operate for, an hour, a day, the weekend, select a location based on the time that you're there. Picking an isolated jetty where there is potential for crime in the middle of the night is probably best for daytime activations, but might need reconsideration for an overnight adventure. Picking a local park might be possible for 24 hours, but the local ranger might not appreciate you setting up a more permanent camp. Often planning works to your advantage. The local council might appreciate you having a chat with them before a contest and might even offer you assistance in the form of local facilities, running water, etc. Consider using the local public open space with a community hall as your base. There's a balance to be found between preparation and turning up on the day. If the location is something that you're only visiting for an hour, you won't need to scout, unless you're planning on a particularly elusive DX contact. But setting up camp for 48 hours with tents, masts, coax, and operating positions will benefit from a visit before the actual event. Make sure that you bring along a radio that can operate on the bands that you're planning to operate on, and remember to turn it on and have a listen. I can tell you that driving for 90 kilometers to scout a location and forgetting to actually turn on the radio is an experience that I cannot recommend. There are many places to choose from. Radio considerations aside, I mentioned shade before. The environment is important. You don't want to set up on the side of a highway with fast-moving traffic, or in a location where people will come right up to your station to get to their cars. You don't want to select a large car park where others will, for inexplicable reasons, park right next to you. Boat ramps and jetties are good. A national park is great. A beachside car park, the top of a hill next to a river, are the kinds of places where you'll find an operating position that will get your mobile station up and running. Bring along stuff. Batteries, squid poles, rope, wire, spare coax, a table, water, a chair, your logbook, a box of tools, the little things that will give you options for when something unexpected happens, like the tree you are planning to use is further away than expected, or the shade moved, or the rubbish bin on site is just a little too close for comfort. Also bring fly spray, a raincoat, some food, and consider any other things that might affect your enjoyment. Essentially, build in some flexibility. I'll leave you with this question. What operating positions have you used, and how successful were they? I'm Onno, Victor Kilo 6, Foxtrot Lima Alpha Bravo.
Daily Minutes zijn dagelijks vanaf ongeveer 1900 uur te beluisteren. De uitzending wordt een dag later om 10:30 ochtends herhaald. Alle mail is welkom op het adres x@xdv.me. Dat is ook te vinden rechts bovenaan de webpagina van de uitzending in www.pa0ete.nl. De Daily Minutes toont iedere dag weer aan de hand van schokkende voorbeelden hoe een hobby mensenlevens kan veranderen. De internetfaciliteiten en studiohardware voor Daily Minutes worden gesponsord door 70MHzShop.nl. 70MHzShop.nl. Thank you.
microfoon naar de toer.